thanks first of all for joining today for this session, which we'll start in a couple of minutes. Still people are, as you can see, they're joining. And today the topic is, as you see, it's a Tableau data visualization and analysis. So let's start with some of the first ground rules. That's what we want to we'll do today is, as we know, this is online session, right? So the best way to communicate is to have a chat, right? So there's a chat box. You can actually post your questions, queries, whatever is you have, and we will try to respond it as soon as possible. Second thing is, please try to be on mute so that we'll not face any background noise. And for video, it's up to you guys. If you want, you can show up your videos, so the video you can switch on. That's not a issue. Yes. So okay, first of all, on this earth, where are you from, guy? Where are you all from? Just I want a quick response. You can type your place in the chat, group chat. Okay, Singapore. Oh wow, Portugal, US, Singapore, Australia, KL, Russia, Ireland, UK. Nice, nice. So we are covering the whole earth, right? Literally. Okay, guys. That's great. That's great. So again, good evening, good morning. I can say anything, right? So, I mean, again, thanks for joining. Also, best part, what I like is this technology, right? That we are connecting with each other for this. And I mean, whether it be COVID or any, but we are actually going to digitalization, and we can see a lot of things we will learn. We do the things or everything online. So thanks to technology again. So let's start now. First of all, let me introduce. So this is me. My name is Pranjal, and I'm co-founder of a company called Exaltis Private Limited, which is based out of Singapore here. I have, based on my experience, I'm most into the analytics domain. So all my past experience, whether it could be on different, the domains, worked on the retail, products, finance, education sector as well. So what I found that basically is the common thing out of all this is the data, right? So I love doing the analysis part of the data, and to again, I want to grow up in that area. So today's session will be again based on those, why this data is important, why analytics is important. So we'll see. And one of my colleague, Gauri, also will be taking you guys through the demo on the Tableau part, which we will cover in the second half of the session. So let's start with this question. How much data do we create every single day? So if we ask this thing, that we, whether we are aware of or not, but we use data extensively, right? So if you talk about the numbers and the figures, we'll have this much number. We'll have 2.5 quintillion. That's a 17 zeros, guys, here in this. So this much data that we create every day, right? So if you see, from where this data got exploded, what is the volume? And here we can, if you see this graph, what it is showing is it was not very old. It's just a decade ago that that it started increasing. The trend, if you see, is a very steep growth. So there was some factor due to the technological advancement, which was not earlier. And after that, after 2010, we saw a lot of different tech enhancements, and also that right now we have these things, this the data, our data got exploded. Now, if you talk about a day in data, that how these are created, this is a very nice chart, very nice, I mean, picture to explain. We use Twitter, so we send the tweets, we send emails, we use a lot of the social media sites, Facebook, Insta, so the pictures, the images that creates, the photos that we upload, the video that we upload. Then again, we have a lot of our connected devices, we have our connected car, our IoT devices. So all this technology, it's just fueled by all the Internet of Things and all those connected devices. Again, thanks to internet. And so that three things, if you see the cloud services, that's what we have, our devices, and then the connections, right? So all this helps, is helping now actually in creating all this data. So, and if you see about if you see the domain or the, industries from how they are using the data, so it's everywhere. It's literally everywhere. If you talk about the travel, we can see those travel companies, they're using this data for their dynamic pricing, to predicting whether the flight will be delayed or not. If you talk about marketing, they predict their customer value. They do some kind of their marketing campaigns like cross-selling, upselling. They also predict whether the customer will churn or not based on the data, the purchase data that they have. If we talk about healthcare, a lot of things that we are predicting, the disease prediction based on the nature of the cells and the images. So these things, we talk about social media, we have, digital marketing, sentiment analysis, we do on the text analysis, we do on the data to do that. Talking about sales industry, we provide discount, they provide the discounts and the offers based on the, the demands and the supply. Again, so if there is any festival or any New Year kind of thing, so what they do, they will just charge the price, and also they can provide different kind of discounts as well. If you talk about automation, we have now, we can see self-driving cars, pilotless aircraft is still not there, but surely we have the drones nowadays. The last one but not the least is about the credit and insurance. It's about more finance and banking, where we predict based on that data that, okay, this claim is valid or not, whether we should approve any loan or not to a person. We also predict the fraud detection, the risk detection, to avoid any kinds of risk in the industry, right? So if you see in all these industries, they are using the data, right, to do their business. So that's the very very basic requirement for those industries. Okay, so very known statement, data is the new oil. There are a lot of people who compared this data with the oil. Now, there are certain reason why they call this as data as the new oil. The first reason is, it's very common, is again, the value of the oil is oil is precious, right? The same for any form, for any industry, data is also precious. Now, there's a guy, this Clive Ambi, those who don't know, he's he's a great UK mathematician. And what he pointed out, and what was his philosophy based on this, is he compared the data with the oil. Just like oil in its crude form, in its raw form, is not so much valuable, right? So how oil becomes valuable when we clean it, when we refine it, when we convert that crude oil into different products, different chemicals, products, and all this, so then it becomes valuable. Same thing applies for the data as well. Data in the raw form is very dirty. Literally, it's very dirty. It's unclean. Now, what for any insights, for any, anything that we want to discover from the data, we need to first clean the data. And after that, it will be more valuable for any company. So these are the certain, so that was the one of the approach that what he saw. And yeah, it's true that nowadays, every companies are just, they are relying on the data. So it's very valuable. Now, talking about the data, what is it? So it's just a collection of facts, numbers, words, measurements, or observations, or even just the description of things. So there are two kind of things. If you see on the right side, this is quantitative and the qualitative. So quantitative can be your discrete numbers or the continuous. And if you talk about the qualitative, it can explain, it is not a numerical, that's what you can actually the count, but it is the hidden meaning of the data also, that also a part of data. So it can be anything. And the sources, if you see on a daily life from where it is coming, is like everything what we do on a daily basis, right? We pull the data from the website, we pull data from CRM, we do a lot of purchasing on our mobile, we use the social sites to do the smart TV data, we have the third party data, mobile data, all these are the sources that we have now that we use on a daily basis, right? So everything is data. I mean, if you see now, what can we do with the data? Again, it's a very good question, because now, again, I told you, right, the data is there, but the best part is how you are using that data, and then it makes that invaluable. So if you see, if the first one is exploratory data analysis, it's very, very common term in the field of data analytics. What we call it, short form is EDA. EDA is exploratory data analysis. So what we do is we explore the data that we have. We apply some of the techniques to do that. And after the exploration, what we can do is we derive useful insights from the data. So when you call the insights useful insights, that's something very important. That is what is hidden in the data. We can't see without exploring it. So once we explore, then we derive the useful insights. After that, we create some kind of dashboards and reports for our management to make it more visible. And then after that, we derive some new inferences from that. So this is all these things, just some of the examples that what we can do with this data. Now, let's talk about the analytics, because when we talk about the data, we do a lot of analytics, as just I mentioned, to do the any of EDA, things to do, or any kind of insights what we want to do. Now, what is analytics? I mean, the definition is written here from Wikipedia, but it's a very simple term. In the layman term, if we just talk about the analytics, analytics is the actually method to find out the hidden data, hidden meaning behind the data, right? So it's the simple, it's the discovery, interpretation, and communication of meaningful patterns in data. So what we can't see directly, analytics helps us getting those things. So that's how, that's what is analytics. And it, again, regardless of the domain, regardless of the industry, which is there, if there is data, there is analytics. That's, that is everywhere. And that is why with the help of this technology, with the help of different platforms, we are using analytics a lot. So that's the something which is nowadays very, very popular as well. Now, if you just see this chart is actually explaining us that what we were earlier, we were the journey from what happened. We earlier were just used to find out the what happened with the data, right? Right now, from what happened to the what is the best that we are predicting something. We are predicting our future. We're predicting the future of the the trend, actually, what will happen. So we all came across all these things. What happened? Why did it happen? To what will happen? And now, what is the best that could happen? That's a predictive. So if you see, the collective insight is very much high when you are predicting something, right? And that's what the analytical capabilities is. It's getting more and more mature using all these techniques. So it's just not a descriptive analytics what we used to do earlier, rather than it is more of the predicting the things that what will happen in future. So you can see a lot of different, it's not just a simple, we have a lot of tools, we have a lot of techniques behind it. We do a lot of analysis. We create models, we do machine learning things, we optimize the things, we recommend, we build the recommendation engine. All these things are, they help actually to get this, the final output of the prediction. Now, if we talk more into, so what we'll do, try to cover today is basically two part of the analytics, which is first is, I would say, storytelling, and the other is visualization. So again, this is like three things. First is data, second is your storytelling, then is visualization. So it's a complete part of the data analytics, right? So let's first start with the storytelling. Let's start with the story. So data tells the real story. I mean, I agree with this statement, because it consists everything. It's we are those who actually convert the hidden things from the data to a beautiful story, to an unforgettable story. And that is where the importance of that data lies, right? So let's see, what is storytelling? Storytelling is basically used in design as a technique. It's just a technique, right? It's an art, basically, you can say. It's an art to directly connect with the users, connect with the users emotionally, right? So we try to build an empathy, and then we try to connect with them, and then we actually convince them that what the story is saying. So that is how this is the art, right? It's a conveying of the events in words, maybe in images. So it again depends, like how we are trying to pursue the thing, how we are trying to convince the audience what the story that we want to present. Now, what is important, and then I mean, why does storytelling matter? Because first, very important, it makes the data meaningful, right? So for example, if I just pass you and any Excel file or the CSV file, you probably won't understand at a first glance that what this data is, right? But if I just convert that data into a small 2-3 lines of a story, or maybe a beautiful video again with a story, then definitely it would be easy for you to get the meaning of it, right? So that's how story makes data meaningful. Second is your stories tell to sell. So it's very easy to sell the things, to sell whatever you want to using a story. Stories simplify. Yes, again, I just mentioned it is very easy to understand with the help of a story. And stories crystallize takeaways. Why I say this crystallize takeaway? Because just for example, if you go to watch any movie in theater, right? So always what happened at the end, you usually remember, right? At the end of the movie, you remember that, okay. And after a few years, even if I ask you, what happened? What is the story of that movie? You will probably remember and then you can tell it. So that's why the takeaways is that stories helps in that, crystallizes that takeaways. Now, we'll see today what are the different elements. And I would categorize this as in 4 important elements of data storytelling part. So, if you see this happy face on the top of, and the sad face at the beginning and the end also, it is happy. It's just showing that at the beginning we are very confused, we don't know what to do, but with the help of all the analytics tool, at the climax of the story we are happy, and this situation again remained at the at the end part as well. So that is how it shows. So let's see what are the four important elements of the storytelling. First one is know your audience, and that is crucial. That is very, very important. First step, to know your audience. And now, why it is matter is because if you know your audience, you can easily resonate with them. That's all. If the presenter want to present something, and if he knows who all his audience are, it's very easy for him to present in those, in their, just to find their mindset. So it's very helpful to resonate with them. So the communication would be much more effective. And you don't have to explain much more. You can just, suppose, just for example, everyone here is in, suppose, from banking background. I will present some graphs on the banking data, then it will be much more easy for you guys to understand, right? So that's how know your audience is very, very important. What is the first thing that you should ask yourself, know your audience, is that what do I need my audience to know? Why are they here, right? What they want to know. Again, second is what they are expecting. I mean, are they just expecting just to summarize the data, or they want some kind of recommendation or some kind of a strategy so that they can help improving their business or whatever the work they do, right? Those things you should keep in mind. And again, very important part is be bold, because the data, right? It's your data, it's your company. So the data better than anyone else. So that's why be bold and confident on that part. Second is know your purpose and data. So there are 2 things. Again, know your purpose and know your data, right? So why again know your purpose? Is before, actually, when you start creating some kind of visualization and graphs, you need to make some sense of the data, right? You need to find out some story that can actually speak to the audience. So you have to show the data, you have to illuminate that story, you have to present that story, and then you are trying to, you know, that and the message that what you are trying to share, so that they will remember it throughout their life, right? So that is how you should know your purpose. If you talk about the data, it is very important to, you know, to model your data. And when we talk about the modeling, is like there are certain characteristics of the data, right? So in the right side, if you see, there are measures, there are dimensions. I mean, very quickly, like measures are those you know, the attributes which we can aggregate, like sum, like, you know, the sum of the revenue is just a good example. So all those are the average, or all these are which we can aggregate. And the dimensions are basically the features, the categorical values, like country name, like region name, right? So all those things are there, which are called dimensions. So you should understand, you should know actually the data in these, the minute details of the data as well. So third is our craft your message. Now craft your message is again, like how you are going to present a story. The message that what you want to, you know, convey to your audience, how you're going to present it. So it's certain things, that certain questions you should ask yourself, like, okay, maybe the flow or maybe what they want. So you should ask, like, what is your overall goal of your total data analysis? Who is this message intended for? What do you want to answer? What kind of relationship exists in your data? What are the best techniques? All these things, certain, can you highlight specific data points to better get your message across? So all these things, you have to craft it accordingly. I mean, based on the data and the based on the audience as well, right? So this is how you craft the message. And last but not least is your storytelling assets. So when you talk about storytelling assets, it's the tools that what we have. And why it is very important is because every story is unique, right? So when we have a unique story, so we need to think about the unique tool or the unique way how to represent that, right? So that's why we need to choose the tools very carefully, and then we should decide, okay, which tool is best for what kind of data. So again, just to revise, the four things, the four elements that what we just saw is, first is know your audience, that is very important. Second is know your purpose and data. So that was the second. Third is how do you craft your message? And then the tools or the storytelling assets that what you have. These are the four elements of a good storytelling part. Okay. Now, when you talk about the tools, a little bit about this is this is just a very, very few examples. We have the Tableau, we have Power BI, Fusion Charts, D3, even the Microsoft Excel, by the way, it's a very powerful tool as well. The Click View and all those clicks. And so some of the tools, these are available in the market to build a story with the data, where we do some kind of BI tools as well. So all these tools are available in market. And today what we are going to see is the Tableau. But right now we'll see who are the leaders also in our later slides. So we talked about a little bit about the EDA, right? The exploratory data analysis. So what is inside it? Right, what is the main purpose? What is the approach of it? So that is where it differentiates. What we were using earlier approach when we didn't use not using like the data analytics approach. We suppose for any company, the company got some issue or they want to solve some problem. So they have the problem at their first place. On their plate, the problem is itself there. Then they will go look around the data and then they will try to find out a thing. Here, what is the difference is we don't have any problems at the first place. We have only data. We will explore it. We will ask questions from ourselves. What could be the question? What questions we can build from this set of given data, right? So we are creating questionnaire. That's the difference. And to answer those questions, we will again explore the data and then we will get the insights. So that's how the exploratory approach is a little bit different from the traditional approach what we had earlier. Now, when you talk about the storytelling and the data and the storytelling, the third one is our visualization part. As the name suggests, it's nothing but the presentation of data in a more, you know, graphical format, more pictorial, more visual appealing. So how it helps is basically it enables the audience to see the analytics directly, visually. So it will be very, in a very short span of time, they will just see the what the graph is showing and what is the impact it is trying to, try to convey. So those are the things we can, based on the certain patterns, based on the different insights that what we can see from the graphs. And so the technique behind is that we all call it, the practice is basically it's called as data visualization. Now, a lot of graphs are, already at, or the, I mean, the charts are available in all these tools what we saw. But but we need to be very specific. We need to be very clear about the, our requirement, because all the data, there is a different way to present it, right? We need to be very selective in terms of choosing the type of charts that what we have. So suppose for, if you want to who and what, if you want to question these, if you want to answer these questions, we need to have the distribution representation, have some kind of portrait. If you want to how many, then kind of it's a comparison. We have the bar charts, vertical charts, and all those to do a certain kind of comparison. If you want to answer where, we have the map, we have the position in space. All those things are our geographical representation. We want the when, then it's a timeline thing, the trend thing, that how we are going to, what is the current trend and the timelines accordingly. If you want to answer how, we have the flow charts, that complete hierarchy, the relationship between objects and the things. For why, we have multivariable plots are also available. So those kind of things, we need to be very specific based on the data and your requirement, what is the business problem that you want to solve. So then only you can decide what is the best tool, and then out in that tool, which is the best chart to represent it. So that's how the complete cycle is, right? So just for example, a pie chart. Pie chart is very common, very popular when we want to show some kind of proportional or the percentage relationship is that. But again, if you see in the top, it is fine because it has just four categories, the consumer, corporate, home office, and small business. Fine, it looks good. But you see that bottom one, it's like you can't detect anything. It's not even clear because again, there are a lot of categories. So you need to be very specific. Probably for this kind of data, if you have a huge data set, you have more number of categories, then you would rather want to switch to a bar chart or a, the vertical bar chart is there. So then you have to again decide either whether pie chart is good or a bar chart is good, right? Horizontal bar chart, if we talk about, it's a very good representation when you want to compare the length of the categories. So that's how it is very appealing as well and very, very easy to understand. This is stacked bar chart when you want to show the categories as well as the subcategories as well. So for all this kind of data, it can just give you some more details and more information. So that is why we use the stacked bar chart. This is a side-by-side bar chart when you have all the details for each particular category. So suppose for any particular country, what all different categories are there. So it's just a side-by-side, the graphs are there. So that is again a very nice representation. A tree map when we want to show some kind of hierarchical data. And part two whole relationship as well. So based on the based on the color density and based on the size, it differentiates the data values, right? So tree map is also very commonly used. Line chart is best for the when you want to see the trends. How is it happening? How the trend things are like to changing over a period of time. So line chart is used for that, for all the continuous data that we have. And a dual line chart is just you want to compare the two measures over a period of time. That's what again it's a type of line chart only. We use scatter plots to show again the density, to show the trend, like what is the correlation between these two or more than two items, right? So we can draw this particular trend line and then you can see the correlation. So scatter plots is again comparing for the different measures and the patterns what the data have. Histogram is mostly used for the distribution of the data, like how skewed the data is and what is the overall, the structure of that data. So the range kind of thing. So it's a distribution. Now, that was all about the certain charts. Let's talk something about the insights, that what does insight mean? We talked about the data and then insights, but what this actually means. So the earlier, when I talked about the data, it's about the raw data, right? So raw data is basically what would say is a fact, right? So all the data, we can just treat it as fact. So again, important point, data is not an insight, data is a fact, right? So once we have those facts, those data, then we observe. We do some kind of, you know, we observe the data very carefully. And after that, we get insights. And when we talk about the insights, that means we are uncovering a shared meaning, shared value, or a shared need that can be translated into some kind of action. So those insights are actually certain things where we could act on. And that is how it is. The insights are like, it will help in improving our business. It will help us in, you know, to know the things better. Again, with the help of data only. Now we'll talk about a little bit of the actionable insights as well. Before that, the key attributes of an actionable insight is, what are the more attributes? First is alignment. It's that it should be very, very aligned, right? It should be to the context. It should be relevant, very specific to the things. Should be for a noble cause as well, and there must be a clarity. So all these are the actually attributes of actionable insight. So insight can be anything, but what we're talking to here is actionable insights, where we can take some action to do some, you know, to improve the value, to increase the value of your business. So that's how your insights should be, must be actually actionable. Now, I will give you a small example, and probably you might relate it. I will give you an example of the Netflix. How do you get with the help of the data, what is the fact, what was the fact, what are the insight, and what is the action that you actually took? So if you notice, so there was a finding that customers are not watching the entire video, the entire like Netflix video to its full length. So they are just watching 90 to 95%. So this is a fact. This is the data that what they got. Now the insight that they use is, when they discovered, they found that the parts they are not watching are the title, role, and the end credits, right? So if you remember, we also do the same thing when we open any, you know, the lot of episodes are there. So when we start watching first episode of any particular season, so we usually skip the title, role, and then when we are ending the first episode, we again skip the end credits for that, and we move to the next episode. So what was the recommendation? Is what they did is they introduced skip intro at the beginning of the title role and watch next at the beginning of the end credits. So this is the two things that they introduced, and they benchmark those 90 to 95% as complete, as 100%. So see, with the help of the data, with the they got some insight, and they recommend this thing, and they change their business way, the operation, that how they were operating, that now they have benchmarked the 90 to 95% 200% directly, right? So just to give you, to make you more familiar, this is what we saw. We usually try to skip the intro, and here we watch to usually click on the next episode, right, at the end. So this is how. Earlier, it was not there, but again, with the help of data, with the insights, they introduced these two things. So that's a very wonderful example of what is the power of the data and how you can utilize it. Now, stories, again, stories are emotional, stories are memorable, and definitely they are very much impactful. So that's why stories are very important, right? And we should learn how to tell a story with just from the raw data itself. So I just want to focus a little bit here on this chart. So this chart is basically, this we call it a Gartner chart. Gartner is a third-party vendor, which is unbiased. So unbiased means no one can buy it. And actually people pay, companies pay to them to get the actual report, the true report, right? Because this is very authentic report. So if you see here, what it is showing is analytics and business intelligence platform, what is available in market. So this is our latest, I guess, February 2019 data. It's the February 2019, where we can see the right top corner, the leaders is like Microsoft and the Tableau are there on the top. So these two are, so Microsoft, when you talk, Microsoft is actually Microsoft Power BI, is again one of the tool, and then Tableau was also there. So till 2018, Tableau was on the top. So right now, last year and right now also Microsoft is there, but it's again a very competitive market, right? So Microsoft and Tableau, that means Power BI and this Tableau tool, both are very popular, they're in demand, and all the companies, whether I've told you, right, whether it's in any domain, any industry, they're actually trying to move to these kind of tools. So again, because of the new enhancement that it has and the importance and the and they know how it is trying to, how powerful they are. So they are trying to actually move to this one. So those are kind of, both are the leaders in the current market. Now, after this, I will pass. So we'll see a Tableau into more detail. So probably I will pass. I will request my colleague Gauri to take you through the Tableau in more detail. What you will do today is a demo. She's going to show you, and then after that we'll see. Okay, Gauri.
There is measures and dimensions, so we need to take care about these two terminologies in Tableau. And measures are basically the measurable number, like sales, income, etc. And dimensions are the categorical variables, for example, country, age group, so on and so forth. So when you load your data to Tableau, it differentiates the data into measures and dimensions, the numerical variables and the categorical variables, basically. So let's explore Tableau together. What are the things that we are going to see in Tableau today? We are going to import a data set. We'll be applying grouping into that. We'll work with hierarchy. We'll use parameters and use them into our visualization. And we'll also work with filters and finally configure our dashboard. So the data that we have today is the New York arrest data. From that data, we are going to show the total number of arrests, which will be a metric that we'll be using. We'll see the top 10 or top N number of crimes for which we'll be using a parameter. We'll be seeing arrests per jurisdiction and borough. We'll be seeing arrests over time, and then the arrest pattern by age group. And finally, we'll be using some filters in our dashboard so that you can slice this data. At the end, we'll be able to build a dashboard, which you can see in my screen right now. So let us get started. The data that we have is this. This is in a CSV file, and we have this New York arrest data, wherein we have the arrest key. We have the date when the criminal was arrested. We have the TD description. So this is basically the description of the crime they have committed. This offense description is a more aggregated level of the crime description, whereas this ED description is at a more granular level. We have the law category code. So what is the penalty that these criminals had been given after committing these crimes? We have the arrest boroughs, which are the areas from where these criminals had been arrested. We have the arrest precinct, which is nothing but the code that has been given to them. To these arrest boroughs. We have the jurisdiction code. Now this jurisdiction code, you can see are numbers from 0 to some 97 or 99, I guess. Now these jurisdiction codes are actually categories. So zero stands for patrol, 1 stands for housing, 2 stands for transit, and all the other beyond 2, that is from 3 to the rest of the numbers, are actually non-NYPD. So these are the jurisdiction code that has been assigned. We also have the age group of the criminals, the sex of the criminal, the race, and we can also see that we have XY coordinates of the place from which they have been arrested, and we have the latitude and longitude. So XY coordinates are basically the internal coordinate that New York has assigned to the places. We are not going to use that. We are going to use the latitude and longitude, which is globally accepted. So the first thing that we are going to do is we are going to connect this data to Tableau. So this is our Tableau, and we are going to connect to a text file. Now Tableau allows us to connect to numerous data files, but today we are using the CSV file to show this webinar. Now, as soon as I connect this data source to Tableau, you can see that whatever we had seen in the Excel file, we can see in this page as well. Now, Tableau by default converts all these data into some sort of data types. you can see these small icons in my screen. So Tableau has by default converted all these data. It has understood that a REST key is a numeric field, and it has converted it to numbers. It has assigned the data type number to this field. It has understood that this is date, and it has assigned this date calendar icon to this, which is a date data type. Now, if you go beyond, you can see that it has assigned texts, numbers to all the relevant datas. If you go at the extreme right, you can see that you have latitudes and longitudes, and you can see that there is a small globe icon. So Tableau has also understand that these numbers, which is latitudes and longitudes, are not actually numbers, but are actually geo data type. Now, in this panel, you can see, in the screen, you can see the data that you have connected actually shows at the space. And then you have three small icons down, which shows the sheets, the dashboard, and the story. So you can click on each of these. You can add them from here. And by default, it creates sheet one, basically, for us to work on. Now, this is the Tableau canvas that we have, and we are going to use this to show our visualizations. Now, as I mentioned earlier also, that when you connect data to Tableau, it converts it to dimensions and measures. Now, you see that we have not done anything, but Tableau has by default converted some of the columns to dimensions and some of the columns to measures. Now, these are all the columns that were there in our data set. This is at the top is the ribbon, wherein you can perform the tasks, that relevant tasks to your visualizations. You have the columns and row shelf. So mainly whatever visualizations we are going to show you will be, we have to pull these dimensions and measures to the rows and columns shelves to actually get the visualizations. We have a show me over here. This is basically, we can take reference to see that what all we can, what are the graphs available in Tableau and what all we can leverage from Tableau in our data. And then we have something called a marks pane over here. So this is used basically to increase details in the visualizations that we are going to see, and we'll explain you more when we go along and create visuals. We have the filters pane. By the name itself, you can understand that this is basically where we can put the dimensions and or measures and apply filters to the data or visualization. And then we also have the pages, wherein you can actually see the data in action, like there will be motion to your visualizations. And last but not the least, this is the data pane, and this is the analytics pane. We'll see that as well, that what this analytics pane also does. So let's get started. So the first thing that we are going to show you today is the number of arrests. So this arrest is basically the metric that we are going to use for our visualization. So that is the first thing that we are going to show from our data, that what is the number of arrests that has happened. So we are going to name this sheet as arrests. And then we are going to just give some formatting to this sheet. And then we have this dimensions and measures. Now, in order to get the number of arrests in the data, what do we need? We need the count of the number of arrests that has happened. Now, we can count that from the arrest key, but then you can see that by default Tableau has taken arrest key as a dimension, but with dimensions are the categories. We cannot perform any sort of aggregation on this arrest key. So we need to convert this arrest key to a measure. How do we do that? We need to click here, and then we need to convert this to a measure in order to have some aggregation and use them into our visualization. Now we are going to drag this, and we can see that we get a huge number, which is not correct, of course, because by default, Tableau has taken the sum of each arrest key numbers that we had, but we don't need that. We need the count of this. So we are going to convert this to count, and now we can see that the total number of arrests is actually 18,872. Now, what we can do is, if we want to see the number of arrests per gender, say, or within the age group, we need to filter, we need to add a filter to this, right? So what we are going to do is, we are going to add some filter to this age group. We are going to select all and then apply and okay. So we have added this filter, but we are not showing it anywhere. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to show this filter and then convert this to a dropdown, because we don't need this in the form of where you can select everything. We need a drop down into this. Now you see, when you have got selected 18 to 24 age group, you can see that 4,303 arrests have happened. Now Tableau has filtered out that age group. So this will be good to, you know, make the report interactive and actually get some good insights out of it, that which age group has committed the maximum number of crimes, say, for example. Now I'm going to clear everything from this. Now I am going to also add the race in our filter, and we are going to select everything and also going to show this as my filter. I'm going to change this value from list to a drop down, and then I'm going to deselect everything. I'm also going to take the gender and select all, apply, and then okay. And I'm going to show this filter as well. Same thing again, I have to change this to a drop down. And here we go. We have got three filters to this visualizations. You can choose any of the filters and see what is the number of arrests that has happened. So this sheet one also, I'm going to rename to arrests. Now, it will be good for us to see the top crimes that has happened in the New York City, right? So what we are going to see is, we are going to show that what are the most occurring crimes that has happened. How do we do that? We need to, first of all, take this offense description into our visualization. Now we are going to add this offense description. We can see all the crimes that has happened, and then we are going to take this arrest key, of course, but again this takes a sum over here. We are going to convert this to a count, and then what we are going to do is, we are going to sort this in a descending order. Now you see that you have got all the crimes that has happened. Now, how about adding this? So this offense description, as I mentioned earlier, was at an aggregate level, right? If I want to have some more, you know, detail into this and basically create a hierarchy of this, so that you can drill down to this particular crime and see what are the description of these crimes, what are the actual crimes that has happened under this. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to create a hierarchy of this data. So let us create a, so we don't have to create, we just need to pull this to offense description, and we are going to name this as offense hierarchy. Now we are going to see, by default it actually takes the hierarchy, and you can actually get the description of all the crimes like within dangerous drugs. Now you also have the small icon which you can expand or collapse accordingly. Now what we can do is, we can also add some more detail to this visualizations. Like for example, we now understood that drugs are one of the most occurring crime. Now what about the penalty that they have been charged for this this crime? Now I would like to also add another detail. I would like to add this law category code into the data, so that I get the for drugs, what is the penalty that they have been charged, right? Now I'm telling that I want to show the top crimes in my analysis, in my visualization. Now how about only showing top 10 crimes? Say for example, I just want to show that I just want to show top 10 crimes in my data. I don't want to show the overall crimes. Now you see that you just get the these 10 crimes, but then this doesn't have that interactivity in the report. Say for example, the report user tomorrow wants to see 20 crimes and not just 10 crimes. So they will come back to you again and then ask you to create a separate visualization, which is not feasible, which is not a feasible option. So what we have is, in Tableau, we can leverage something called parameter, wherein the user can actually give the input that how many crimes, top how many crimes they want to see, and finally get the visualization. So let's see how we can do that. In the top only, we had given 10 by default. Now we are going to create a parameter for that. So this parameter, we are going to give a top n name, and then we are going to apply OK. So you see that we have got a top 10. We can select any number of number, and then you see the visualization changes accordingly. Now I'm going to have a type in over here. I'm not going to show a slider. I'm going to show a type in over here. Now I'm going to change the title of this this visualization. I'm going to give this name as top, and I can also use this parameter in the sheet so that when the user enters 10, it shows top 10 crimes. When the user inputs 20, it shows the top 20 crimes. Now this also I'm going to format a bit. I'm going to bold it and then make it central line. Now you see that I can, from this visualization, we can infer that dangerous drugs was one of the reasons that maximum crime had happened in New York. We are also going to rename this sheet as top. And then we'll be adding another visualization, arrest per jurisdiction and borrow. Now we have this jurisdiction code over here. Remember I told you that zero standard for patrol, one stand for transit, so on and so forth. So what we are going to do is, we had numerous amount of data into the, like a wide range of numbers into this field, but then we need to make some changes into this. How do we do that? We address this problem by creating a group in Tableau. So we are going to create a group. So over here, this zero actually was patrol. So we are going to have all zeros grouped into under patrol. We are going to make one as housing, two as transit, and all the others, all the rest are non-NYPD. So this had been given by the New York police itself. So we know that this is non-NYPD. Now, that is non-New York Police Department. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to take the arrest boroughs and we are going to take the jurisdiction code. Now you see, we have got a divided form of a visualization wherein we can see the boroughs from where the criminals were arrested, and we can also see the jurisdiction codes for each of them. Now what we are going to show, we are going to show the number of arrests that has happened. So we are going to take this arrest key, and again it shows the sum. We are going to convert it to a count over here. Now you see, this is a stacked, side by side stacked chart that Pranjal had mentioned when he was describing you the types of visualization. But we can also not make it so simple and add more details, so that just by looking into this visualization, it can infer that what it is trying to show you. So what we are going to do is, we are going to add this jurisdiction code to colors. Now you can see that for each jurisdictions, we have different colors. We can also add shapes and then add different shapes to each of these jurisdictions. Now we don't need this heading over here. So we are going to hide this field from labels, and we are going to give this sheet a name, arrests per jurisdiction and borough. We are going to format this the same way that we did for the other visual, other worksheets. Then what? We now know that these are arrests per jurisdiction and borough. So we don't need this count of arrest key anymore, right? So we are going to remove this count of arrest key from here, and we're going to remove this title. Since we have the legends over here, we do not need this housing non-NYPD jurisdiction codes as well. So we are going to hide this from show header as well. Next is, we are going to add, so we can see that what is the number of arrests for each of these boroughs as well as the jurisdictions. How about adding an average line that shows each of the average number of arrests within each arrest boroughs? So remember I told you this analytics pane. So we can add an average line from this analytics pane to each of this, and then we can see the number of arrests that has happened, the average number of arrests that has happened in each of these jurisdictions as well as boroughs. Now, just this average doesn't look that great. We are going to edit this, and we are going to show this label. We'll just add some customization to this. We are going to show the computation, which is our average, of course, and we are going to also show the labels, which is the values. Now you see that we have got this average. Now, number of arrests cannot be a decimal. So we are going to change that as well. We are going to make this as a whole number. Now we can see the number of average arrests that has happened per jurisdiction and boroughs. We are going to give a sheet name to this as well, arrests jurisdiction. All right. Next, what we are going to see is we are going to see arrest over time. So this will give a trend to how the arrest pattern is. So for this, we have the date field and we also have the number of arrests. Now we are going to take the number of arrests to the row shelf and we are going to convert this to count. As you all know, I have discussed this previously, and we also are going to take the date. Now you see that we have a null value, which is showing we are going to exclude this null value from our visualization. Now year is at the most aggregate level, right? So that's why we get a dot over here. We get a point over here, but we do not need the arrest to be at the most aggregate level. We want to see the arrest pattern in days, because we have this data of December 2017. So we need to see that how is the arrest pattern by days within December. So for that reason, we are going to convert this to a continuous day type, right? Now you see that you get a continuous chart showing that what is the number of arrests, all right? Now we can add some more detail to this. From this very chart, we can see that just before the Christmas, that is in the week from December 20 to 25, there was actually a spike in the number of arrests. But on the day of Christmas or just after that, there was a little reduction in the number of arrests. We can't say that the police was not active enough at that time. Maybe the crime was little less at that point in those days on the 25th and 26th of December, maybe. Now we can add some more detail to this chart and see that is this case overall or there is this is how it is for each of the boroughs. Now we are also going to add this arrest borough to the color shelf and see that for each of these arrest boroughs, actually we have a lesser number of arrests on the 25th, whereas just before the 25th, we have a good number of arrests. Now, Staten Island is actually having the least number of arrests. We can infer that maybe because we have less population in this region, we have less number of arrests. Now, we have something called tooltip over here. We have something called labels over here. Now, if we want to show the labels number of arrests, we can do that by bringing the arrest keys to this label. First of all, this shows the sum, which is not correct. And second of all, adding all these details to this visualization actually makes it very cluttered. We do not need our visualization to be so cluttered, and actually we cannot infer that what we are trying to see. So we are not going to add everything. We are going to remove, first of all, this from our tool label. And then what we are going to do is we are just going to show the ones with the highest numbers. So some numbers will not be showing all the numbers. So we are going to this way, just show some of them, which actually shows the number, maximum number of arrests. All right. So this is the arrests over time. So this also I'm going to format. Now, if you see that here I have changed the name in the sheet, and so by default Tableau takes the sheet name whatever I had given, so I don't mind that, and I will basically keep this sheet name. And then we'll add another visualization which will show the arrests by age pattern. Now for this visualization, we are going to see how we can leverage the map visual in Tableau. Now see, in the measures field, we have latitude and longitudes. Basically, latitudes and longitudes are the coordinates of countries or regions, which are actually not measures. Those are not measurable values. Those are dimensions. Those are categorical values. Remember, we had mentioned that country is actually categorical variables. So these latitude and longitude, Tableau has mistakenly taken it as measures because it has seen numbers into it. But these are not measures, so we have to convert them to a dimension. So both latitude and longitude, we have to convert them to dimension. Now, if we click on this latitude and longitude, we can see that we got a map visual. Now, we need to change this to map from the marks card. And then we need to, what other detail we need to add into this visual? See, by default, it is showing the number of crimes that has happened. Now we need to show the age over here. Now for that reason, I'm going to pull the age group into the color shelf, which will actually show the difference in each of the colors and age group over here. Now I'm going to change this map to a different style. I'm going to change this to a street style because this gray map I somehow did not like. Now you can see a proper map visual over here with the age group. Now I'm going to rename this sheet as array by age and bold it and make it central aligned. All right. And I'm also going to rename this sheet as age. Now we have created these visuals. Now is the time that we add these visuals into a dashboard. So this is a dashboard. Now by default, it takes the size, which is a small one. We are going to make this automatic so that we get the whole canvas to actually drop all our visuals that we have created into this sheet. So the first thing that we are going to do over here is we are going to add a dashboard title, a good title to this, which will be New York Crime Analysis. And we are going to again make this bold and central aligned, apply and then okay. We are going to increase this a bit. And now we are going to start off with placing the visuals over here. Now, by default, this is a tiled way of putting the visuals into this. What happens here is that Tableau actually takes care of the size of all the visuals over here. Once I start doing, you'll get a better understanding. Say, for example, I have dropped this top 10 crimes. So Tableau is taking over all this space, this whole space. Next, I'm going to drop the arrest jurisdiction over here. Now it has divided the page into two halves and it has placed these two visuals. Similarly, I'm going to place the arrest over time and I'm going to place the arrest by age as well. Now you see that all these legends are stacked over here in the right hand side. Now we don't want our legends to be stacked over here, but we want these to be below these visuals. I'm sorry. It has taken everything together. Just a moment. I have to select one by one. You have to be a bit careful while doing this because this is in tile format. So you have to be a bit careful while dragging this. Otherwise it will take the whole thing and it will place into the screen. Now what we are going to do is we are going to place this age group over here in the legend. And then we are going to place this arrest borrow over here. Now you see that we already have this housing legend, which are in colors. So we do not need this shapes also to be over here. So we can remove this shapes. Now this top N was solely for this top 10 crimes, right? Now this is where you can select the top crimes. So what we are going to do is we are going to pin this to the top 10 crime visualization. Now we are not keeping this tiled anymore. We want it to be floating, and let us keep wherever we want. Let us keep this this selection option wherever we want. Now we are going to add a bit of formatting to this. What we are going to do is dashboard and then formatting. So what we are going to do is we are going to apply a gray shade to this and keep the font white, or black was better. And then we are going to apply a gray shade to all the other worksheets as well. Now we have another metric card, remember, that we had created previously. Now we are going to pull that metric card over here. Now see, because it is in tiled format, it has taken the whole area. We are going to actually make it floating again and then adjust it at the top. So again, like a reminder, you need to be careful while dealing with these in Tableau. Next is the age group. This is the filter that we had. So this filter will actually be interactive filter, and you can actually filter out everything and see how all the visuals changes. We are going to show you that in a while. So first, let me place all these filters at the top. We are going to keep it floating and then adjust it over here, reduce the size of this, and then we are going to make this also floating, adjust it and place it over here. And next is the gender, which we are going to select and make it floating. And finally, adjust it over here. All right. Now you see that since everything from that right corner have been removed, we have a bit of problem over here. Okay, sorry. Never mind. Let this be like that. I mean, we have to be a bit careful while doing this. So somehow we have managed to actually adjust everything in this. Okay, all right. Now you see that we have to make our visuals interactive to each other. Now, say for example, I select age group from this. Now you see nothing is getting changed actually. So what we need to do is we need to go to this filter where we had actually used the filter, and this filter actually shows that it is only applied to this worksheet, only this worksheet. We are going to make it available to all the other worksheets by selecting all using this data source. All right, now if I go to the dashboard, now if I select age group, you can see that all the other visuals are changing accordingly. Say 25 to 44, you can see that all the other visuals are changing accordingly. So I'm going to clear the filters. Now, you would also like to make the visuals interactive in a way that when I click dangerous drugs, for example, nothing actually reflects, no changes reflect, but I would like to make this also interactive so that when you select each of these filter, each of the option in these visualizations, the other visualizations also reflect the change. Say for example, now I click dangerous drugs, you can see that, all right, so Brooklyn had the maximum number of arrests on December 28th or 19th. So this is how it changes. This is how the dashboards are interactive with each other. The visuals are interactive with each other. Now what happens is, you see, you already have this arrest over time. You can remove this title I showed you to remove from this arrest per jurisdiction, right? So to make the visually more good and make the visual more meaningful, you need to take care of the aesthetics of the visualizations as well. So the story that we can tell from this, or the insight that we can draw from this, is that the maximum number of crimes that has happened is because of dangerous drugs. we can see that Brooklyn and Manhattan had the maximum number of arrests. The age group was maximum for 25 to 44. And then we can also see that just before the Christmas holidays, the crime rate was actually more. So we can just make some story out of it. We can draw the insight that maybe because of the, you know, the holiday season, the drugs crime was more, so on and so forth. So this is how we actually analyze the data. We actually tell the story from this data. So this was it to show you that how from just numbers, you can build something like this and draw meaningful insight out of this data. So if anybody has any questions at this point of time, you can please ask and we'll be answering the questions. Yes, so I got a question that can you repeat why you changed latitude and longitude to dimension? Well, let me go back to the where I had used that. So now latitude and longitude is actually a categorical variable, right? Because latitude and longitude actually shows the interaction of the latitudes and longitudes of a place. So basically the information that we have behind latitudes and longitudes is of place. All right. So because of that, we need to convert the latitude longitude to dimension. Tableau did not understand at first because it had seen the numbers. Well, let me go to the data source. Latitudes and longitudes had numbers over here, right? Now Tableau interpreted it to be measures because these are numerical values, and that's why it has taken measures over here. Now, for example, if I want to show you, what if I don't change this latitude? Okay, I have to convert this again. If I don't change this latitude and longitude to measures, you would have got an aggregated value of latitudes and longitudes, say, for example, sum or count or average. That is not what we wanted. That's why we changed it to a dimension. All right. We'll address some of the questions and then hand it over this to Pranjal again to take it forward. And if any questions are there, we'll be addressing those as well. So Pranjal.
Yes, Corey. But before that, I can see some of the questions in the chat group as well.
Okay. I can't see the questions. Why am I not able to see the questions? I'm sorry, guys, but I am not able to see the questions in my Zoom. Yep. Yes, of course we can perform other slice and drill down operations as well. So which did not cover in this webinar, but then of course you can perform n number of slicing and dicing in Tableau and get to various insights out of the data. Is there a difference what we place in columns and rows? Yes, of course. So basically, so it depends on what you actually want to show in your visualization through the rows and columns pane. So for example, if I show you this, so I basically wanted to show this chart wherein I wanted to show all my dates in the columns. These are the columns, right? These are the rows. So I wanted to show all the dates in my column. So that is the reason I had put arrest date to the column shelf. So it depends on what you are actually trying to show, and then put the accurate that visual to the columns or rows shelf. So so that is a separate, you know, I mean, it is not covered in this webinar, of course. If you would like to explore more, do drop us a note and we'll be very happy to actually help you out in this. So yeah, so you can actually connect to various other data sources and web URL, but that is not what we are covering today in this webinar. So yeah, do we look at the data and look for insights or plan the story to tell? So again, Pranjal already told you before I took it over. So in order to tell your story, the insight that you have from your story, you need to first of all understand your audience, who your audience is. And based on that, you need to craft the message that you are trying to show, right? Say for example, if a marketing officer wants to see a visualization, see the insights of your data, and you show the say for example sales numbers or profit numbers, which is relatable, but then he will be more into studying the revenue. He would be more interested into studying the revenue of the company and so on and so forth.
Yeah, so we'll see some of the examples of the what we call as good visualizations and dashboard. So there is no any perfect definition of what we call as good visualization or bad visualization. It's just that it should be visually appealing and it should be very clear. So that's how we define some charts and the dashboards as the good one. Suppose, for example, this is the first one what we'll see is very concise. If you see the two graphs, one is related to your own different company and the other one is your profit. So for five different products or on yearly basis. So you see these graphs are very clear, very concise. What they're trying to demonstrate is, at one glance, you can actually describe what the things are, right? So this we call as a good one. This is again a dashboard, which is showing all the customer distribution for any firm, right? So we have different KPIs. We have different items that what it is predicting. So clear, so nice, with proper color distribution as well. This again considered as a good one. This one, if you talk about a little bit, it can be modified, but again, it's a quite informative as well. And things are, they're trying to put a lot of information as well. So it should be fine. But we can probably work out on this one a little bit. This again is a sales performance dashboard when we work for any sales firm. So it tries to use the different data, different KPIs again. Probably we can add a little bit more flavor of the color to enhance it. But overall, it's again a good. Let's see some not so good visualization. Again, I mentioned we'll see some. We all love pie chart, right? Pie charts we use very commonly. What about this one? Right, definitely you don't want to create something like this. So what it is showing is it's 100 most active tweeters, right? So as I showed you earlier as well, that if you have a lot of categories, you have too much data to show, probably don't go for the pie chart. That's not a very good option to do that. So again, you have to see the data and then you have to choose the graphs and the charts accordingly, right? Or this one. It's a 3D graph, like 3D graph, 3D charts are available in almost all the tools. So, I mean, it doesn't mean that we have to use that again based on the data. And personally, I don't like, I don't feel why 3D charts are like useful at all. We don't usually use it. It's not much informative as well. So basically, we should avoid that using the 3D charts at all. This one, this is, something I would say, I don't want to see it at the in like more than 2 seconds. The reason is, again, it's that the data is overwhelming, right? It is some too much text in that. So we should avoid writing too much text again. It should be very numeric, very clear cut things should be there, very clean. So that is why it's not a good actually example of any good visualization. Yeah, so after this, I mean, we'll just the last point I would want to say is think story, not charts. Because charts is something that that will come up with the data, and then important is the how you are telling a story based out of that chart and the data behind it, right? So that is how we tell any story. Now, what next? We saw the data, we saw today the visualization storytelling part, we saw how like using one of the tool Tableau, how we can do the thing, how we could analyze, how we can create the charts, how we can create the dashboard, and then how we can tell a story behind it, right? We'll see our next online workshops. I mean, for what next I asked, so if you guys are interested, this we are going to conduct two sessions, two workshops. It would be a full hands-on session on one on 23rd of May and the other one on 20th June. The target audience is for beginners, those who want to learn Tableau from scratch. So the topic would be, again, the name of the topic would be data visualization and analytics, which is the extensive hands-on work workshop for full day, 8 hours. And those who actually want, they can register your interest at this website. Probably you will see what all things, if you are like, if you want to go, what are the different topics that we are going to cover, we can do that as well. And yes, so yeah, that's all. I mean, you guys, if you want, you can ask any questions. Again, we are here to answer you any of the any doubts related to Tableau, related to data analytics. And now I can see the chat board chat, and you can post your questions there.
Okay, great presentation, guys. Thank you everybody for joining us today. And you know, we'll be around for a few minutes. So, you know, in case you guys have any questions, do put them up in the chat. You know, our speakers will take those questions with you. If not, you can write into us as well with any queries you may have. And you know, just keep in touch with our pages, and you know, you'll be invited to more such fun and you know, and learning session. So, you know, thanks for joining in once again.